to add the planetary perturbation. What will the planetary perturbation make? They will move the reference frame. And that's something... So we have basically... and what will be presented is in fact... and it's quite clever, in fact. It's from the paper of Kinoshita, 1977. He's the one who did that for the rotation. It's a theory of rotation of the rigid Earth. And you have the problem is you will have. You have the ecliptic. Yeah. So this will be a fixed ecliptic. But then you have the moving ecliptic. So this is the ecliptic at time t. And then you have the plane of the sorry for Kinoshita. This will be the plane of the of G, the orthogonal to G, and you have the plane of the equator somewhere here. It doesn't. Okay. But what we are interested here, we don't move the angular momentum, we don't move the equator, but we move the reference frame. So basically, we want to go from variables that are linked, and here is the origin. So the two ways they are defined. So you have the longitude of the node, the inclination here. And we want to go from variables that are in the fixed reference frame to variables that are in the moving reference frame. So basically, we will go from the envoyé variable in the fixed reference frame. So I call them to the variable in the moving reference frame. So what is what? We have to see what angles are which angle. This one here is I. This one is I star. This one is what I called N I star in the previous picture. And this is the origin of the reference frame. So this is H, this is H, so this one here is H minus omega, and this one will be H dot minus, no, H minus omega, and this one is H dot minus omega. I define H, just the way I define H here, is just this angle plus this angle. So I define this as being H minus omega. It's a definition. It's not, so this here has been defined some slightly differently from the, and okay, so we have moved, what do we have moved? We have moved this one. We have moved, I should write always which one is which, I is H. Well, we have moved this one. We have not moved J. And we have not moved L. So this one is the same. This one is the same. So we just want to make a change of variable from this to here. We have this change of variable to make. And I don't know I don't know another way to do it than to use this conservation. So the idea is whenever you have something that depends on time, you know, in Hamiltonian formalism, very often you don't like time. So I don't like time. I never know how to make change of variable that depend on time. Where to put the sign, where not to put it. So I use the extended phase space, where you have as additional coordinate the opposite of the energy and time. And then here you look, we will look to the conservation of the form PdQ minus HdT. So you know that, in fact, very often it's preferred you think of it with the second form, but you can think of it at the conservation of this up to a differential, up to a ds. So this would be equal to the sum of p star q star minus p star pt, we keep the same time, and plus eventually some differential. But in fact, in this case, it will be also zero. So it will be also, this is the general form of a change, of a canonical change of variable. But in this case, this will be also zero, like in the change of variable I was showing previously. So basically what we have to compute, we have to compute the differential sum of we have to compute the difference of the two here. We have to compute, we want that this is equal to that, so we have to compute sum of PdQ minus HdT minus sum of P star Q star.
Jacques, excuse me. H and H star now are energies.
Yes. Okay. So this will
put it in there.
Oh yes. You are right. I put a big
this.
Better. Yes. You're right. And this, you want to write it like that. So this is what you want to show. You want to show that this difference of differential form can be expressed as the differential form that depends on here t. And that will give you the change, that's the new Hamiltonian. That the old Hamiltonian, the new Hamiltonian. So you have the change of the Hamiltonian you need to make in order that this is equal to that you have this equality. So basically what you need to do is to compute this difference and show that it is a nice differential form that can be expressed as a variation of the energy. And very often, you know, you have this thing which is called spherical trigonometry. And one of my usual advice for students is to say, never use spherical trigonometry, use rotation and use equality of rotation. You take a vector, you make it go through another vector to two sets of rotation, and you have the equality, everything you can find with spherical trigonometry, you can find it with composition of rotation. But it's not true. In this case, you need to do something which I don't know how to do in another way, which is to use something which is not so written in so many places. Also, it's very old. You can find it, for example, in some book of Andrieux, but even before, it's some book of the 18th century or the 19th century, or any book. It's a differential form of spherical trigonometry. So you thought spherical trigonometry was something complex, but you should go to differential spherical trigonometry. And so as we don't have that much time, I will not go very far on that, but basically, because you need to express, so what is this form, what do you need to compute? I will write it here. You want to compute. So it will be. So G dG plus H dH minus G star. So this one is, I will say we didn't change it, minus h star. This is what you want to compute. And h here is cosine I, is g cosine I, and this is g cosine I star. So at least, and as g is constant, you see that we can get rid of all the g, at least for the moment. Cosine I, get rid of this one, and cosine I star. Okay, so this is what we want to compute. So you see, everything now is well here. Except what is G? Oh, G is here. It's a coordinate of this one. So G minus G star, G, this is G star minus G here in between the two. So basically, we have everything. I just verify. We have G, we have H, we have G star, we have H star. So you see, you have D of G minus G star plus cosine I dH minus cosine I star dH star. And the formula we will use, which can be derived from the other, it's a formula that can be derived from other spherical trigonometric formula. It says that in a usual spherical triangle with A, so A, B, C, B, C, you have dA equal cos C dB plus cos B dC plus, you have two formula that we will sine B sine C dA and another one with sine C sine B dA. So you see, it's nice because it relates the differential, which is what we need here. I will not make all the computation because I want to show you some results at the end. But if you do all that, and if you use also the normal trigonometric formula in the spherical triangle, you will find at the end that everything works, and that you obtain this difference that will give you your new Hamiltonian. This difference is equal to so it will be H minus H star equal to, you find that it's equal, so the differential H minus H star dt. Yes, this is where I was confused. So at the end, it's this. It's H 1 minus cosine d omega plus square root of g square minus h square sine I cosine h minus omega d omega over dt minus sine de h minus omega di, not over dt, di. So you have this, and thus you get a new Hamiltonian just by dividing by dt, and which makes appear here the derivative of the orbital motion. So basically, you have the new Hamiltonian, that is a driving term, that depends on the orbital motion. E is the inclination, omega is the node, and the inclination and the derivative. And what I have shown in is that you can write this in a form that is a little bit more easy to understand. You can write this as your Hamiltonian. So your Hamiltonian is the Hamiltonian you had before, so H0, plus a driving term, and the driving term is just 2C H C H plus L square root of 1. So it's this one, it's minus G2 minus the same thing, and it's here, it will be just A of T sine H plus B of T cosine H. And where A and B are, I don't write them here, but they are A and B, A, C of T, A and B are dependent on the orbital motion. And they are roughly the derivative. So A is nearly Q dot, where Q, it's another variable, but Q is sine pi over 2 cosine omega, and B is roughly P dot is sine pi over 2 sine omega. Just what is important is that you can write then all these driving terms. You can take basically A plus IB, and this you can write it as a sum of periodic term like that, this will be the forcing from the planet. This is basically the quasi-periodic expansion of the planetary orbit, of the planetary change of inclination. And you see, this appears as a quasi-periodic perturbation of the initial precession, which was the pure periodic term, pure rotation. So you have a pure rotation, and here you can think of it of plenty of harmonic terms. So it will be, each term individually will be like a pendulum, and you have plenty of pendulum. So you have plenty of pendulum, and if this pendulum overlap, you will have chaotic motion. If they don't overlap, you will still have oscillation. And I will maybe now go to this to this button. So you see, until you introduce the planetary perturbation, which effect is just to move the orbit of the plane, the plane of the orbit, you have, the only thing you have is really a uniform precession at constant obliquity or nearly constant. See, constant obliquity, uniform precession. Even if you take into account the shape of the body, you will have, of course, some short term that we have averaged, but this will be short term that will not change much in time. So you basically have nothing. You have just this pure precession. And it's only the perturbation due to the fact that you move the plane of the orbit that will change something. So maybe we can... So this is the equation I arrived to here. You see, we have, and this is with a expression that is slightly, it's similar, x is just the cosine of the obliquity, so cosine of pi. We forget about g, that is a constant, and we have just the cosine of the obliquity. So this is all what we did yesterday and even in the first session is here, just this part. But this part with two pieces, the part related to the tidal effect of the sun, the part related to the tidal effect, no, the contrary, of the moon and of the sun. I have suppress here the 1 minus e squared to the power 3 half, and here the same thing, multiply by the part due to the inclination of the orbit, but it's the essential piece here. If you just take the integrable part, you integrate it, here c is in fact the opposite of the h, just the opposite variable, but it doesn't matter. You have that the precession is a derivative of x, so it's the action variable is constant, and the precession is just a uniform motion with velocity alpha cosine of the obliquity. And now you have all these terms that come from the change of the orbit of the Earth due to the planetary perturbation. So you can expand it in a series of periodic terms like that. This will be the secular motion of the plane of the orbit. And what is important, so if you make a first order solution, you see, if you make a zero order solution, what is the zero order solution of this problem? It is when you suppress this, you take only the integrable part. You get this. X is constant, and the precession is just pt where p is alpha cosine epsilon 0. Then if you make a first order solution, I just take this and input it in the second order member. What I will get, I will just write down the equation. I compute the derivative. I obtain this. So I find that the obliquity has an expression that is quasi-periodic. You will have periodic term that has this forcing term. And if you integrate at first order, you find that x is x0 plus this. You can think it's constant at first order. Plus, here, psi is pt, so when you divide by nu k plus p, sine omega k plus pt plus psi 0. So this is a first order integration, and you find that the obliquity will move with frequency that are a sum of the precessing frequency of the pure proper frequency of the precession of the Earth plus one of the driving frequency, and you will have a divisor that is equal to this sum. This will be okay as long as you are not close to a resonance, as long as this is not close to zero. When it is close to zero, you have really the phase space of a resonance, like I was showing briefly, the phase space of a pendulum. And if you have several of these that are close together, you can make a kind of Cherenkov approximation. When you overlap the resonant island, you have chaotic behavior. So yes, here you have a small divisor. So what now we want to know, what are these perturbations and how do they compare with the precession of the Earth? So if you look to the evolution of the inclination of the Earth, this is it. It's you know, it's moving with period of a few 10,000 years to a few million years. This is over 2 billion years, and I can show you it here. So this is the time here in thousands of years. Here it's the projection of the plane. So you see, this is the motion of the perihelion. The planet is placed at the perihelion. So you have perihelion precession of the perihelion, and you don't see much the change of eccentricity because, you know, visually it's like eccentricity square. What you see is the shift of the orbit, which is like eccentricity. But in the plane, you see better the change of inclination, and it's this change that will be the driving term for this for the precession. You see that it's really changing, and this is what will be the input for this A plus B term that perturbs the pure rotator, that is the precessing of the Earth without external potential. So you see that it's moving. It's not. And we already had 1.5 million years that passed. So the effect on the Earth. So you see, this time it's rotating the right way in reverse. It's just because. So you can see that we have the precession, and you see a small oscillation of the spin axis. You don't see it much, but you see it because the circle is changing size. This small change is due to the planetary perturbation. If you make the first order solution, like I was showing before, you will get precisely this oscillation. Here we stop the precessing motion to see the oscillation that is due to the planetary perturbation. So these are the ones that are important in the reconstruction of the past climate of the Earth. You see, like here, for example, you have this small oscillation due to the planetary perturbation. It's about 1.3 degrees from plus minus 1.3 degrees from the present value. But then it adds, you have the change in eccentricity. So this will lead, this period of this are about 40,000 years, because it's not the 20, the precession is 23,000 years, but then you add one of the driving term frequency, and this gives, there are about 100,000 years, and this gives 40,000 years as frequency, the main frequency. And this will change the insulation on the surface of the Earth, and this you can find back in the ice here. This is a reconstruction, this is a computed insulation, so from this orbital solution. And this is a comparison of 400,000 years compared to a variation of oxygen 18, which is an indicator of the global temperature on the Earth at the time. And you see that you have a very good correlation between the two. So we can use the astronomical solution as a time scale for the ice core. But as we are here in Roma, I thought it would be nice to take something a little bit more closely related than core in Antarctica, especially, you know, with this temperature. So I took, in fact, happened, you see, this is just the geology of Rome, and it was published yesterday. So you can see very fresh paper. No, it was in, yes, in the September issue of the Earth and Planetary Science Review. And it's some sedimentary analysis that is obtained in the several holes that have been used that were cored for other reasons, but they use the hole. And they, you see, they make a correlation of, here again, they measure the variation of oxygen 18 in the sediment, and they correlate it with the variation of insulation that is obtained using the variation of the orbit of the Earth and the obliquity. And this is done from, so you see, it's not very old, it's very recent sediment in the last million years. So it shows the variation, in fact, the ice age, all the passage of the various ice age in the past million years. Now, I come back to this. You see, what is important is this forcing term here. And what will be important is how do this frequency compare with the precession frequency, whether you have resonance or not. So this precession frequency is just alpha cosine of the obliquity. So you can it will change with the obliquity. Here, for example, you see in this curve here is the precession frequency. The precession frequency, the measured precession frequency for various obliquities. So it changes as a cosine curve. So this is a nice experiment you can do. You take the spin axis of the Earth, you tilt it down. So right now it's here, 23 degrees, and you tilt it down. When you tilt it down, you get a smaller precession period, alpha cosine of the obliquity. And this is the spectrum of the forcing term, the A plus B term of previously. So when you reach, in fact, the first big peak, then you will get a resonance. But in fact, here you see that not only you have a resonance, you have an overlap of all the resonance, which leads to a chaotic zone. And in this chaotic zone, you will have very strong chaotic behavior. So basically, this is the minimum and maximum value of the obliquity. Basically, until you reach 60 degrees, nothing much happens. You have just small variation of the obliquity, which you could obtain by this first order solution, which I was showing just before. But when you get to the first resonance, immediately it's much more complicated. You get this chaotic behavior. You really go on the whole extent of the chaotic zone. So you go from 60 to 90 degrees. that's it. And I show you the beta, the coefficient, is the effect is due both from the sun and from the moon. And it's the tidal effect of the sun, the tidal effect of the moon. So it's the mass divided by the distance to the cube. And you know that these two tidal effects are comparable, and even the one from the moon is twice the one from the sun, which tells you that the density of the moon is twice the density of the sun. Yes. Because the two values are identical if the density were the same, because we have eclipses. So they have the same apparent diameter. So the difference of the two is just due to the density. So, but if you remove the moon, you remove 2/3 of the effect. So the precession frequency will be 1/3 of the present precession frequency. Then you will be immediately in resonance with all the orbital terms, and you will get this picture with a chaotic zone that goes from 0 to 90 degrees in basically two boxes or several boxes. I have 4 minutes left. I'm looking to the time. Don't worry. So you can go anywhere from 0 to 90 degrees. You will go fast in 60 degrees, and you will need some more time to go across, but you will be able to do it most of the time. So this is a picture of what you can get by the evolution in time of the moon, because you know that due to tidal dissipation in the Earth-Moon system, the moon is going out. So you don't need to take it off. It goes out by itself. And as it goes out, the tidal effect is like the cube of the distance. So you will have, as time goes on here, in billions of years, the moon goes away, and as the moon goes away, you see on the top here you have the moon, the Earth's moon system, and you have the chaotic zone from 60 degrees to 90 degrees. But when the moon goes away, the precession constant decreases, and this is a variation of the obliquity, not much, until you reach the resonance, in which case you can go anywhere from 0 to 90 degrees. And I think I will stop here because I've done my time.
So many thanks for these very nice results, very nice lectures. And before the break, I open for one or two questions.
Well, just to refresh me, to refresh my memory, and if you do the same for Venus, you can have a complete tilt.
No, it's more complicated, because if you do the same, you will have basically the same picture for all the inner planets, because the background is the computation of the stability of a spin axis of a given frequency. It depends essentially on the planetary perturbation, and are roughly the same for all the inner planets. Basically, stronger for Perturb, Mars is a little bit. The picture is roughly the same. Mm-hmm. So then, what happened for a planet like Venus? You will have the same picture. So the thing that happened here in the future, as the tidal effect is much stronger, has already happened to Venus. So Venus has crossed this resonant region, has crossed this chaotic region. But in the case of Venus, there are three additional things. One, it's close, as it is close to the sun, the rotation has been dumped much more. So you have a rotation that went to roughly zero. Once you go to this very low rotation state, you also have a change in the obliquity, which tend to drive the obliquity into a perpendicular position. But you have two additional forces. You have the Kormantal effect, which can do something slightly different. It slows down also the rotation, but if you are above 90 degrees, you go on the top. If you are below 90 degrees, you go below. You want to suppress the effect, so you want to align. You want to align. But then you have an additional effect, which is the the torque exerted on the atmosphere. And the torque exerted on the atmosphere, it acts only when you are close to synchronization, because it's when it will be strong. And this torque will change the equilibrium at the end. I can show that. Can you stop the projector? In fact, it's a simple but relatively nice analysis you can make, which is that when you have a tidal dissipation, you have here the rotation speed over the orbital speed. What does the tidal dissipation? When you are, and this is the variation of the rotational speed. When you have a bulge, when you have here, this bulge, as long as you rotate faster than the perturbing, than the sun, for example, around the planet, or so as long as the orbital rotational motion is larger than the orbital motion, you have a tidal torque that tends to slow down the planet. So here, you are negative omega dot. When you are above here, you are negative, and when you are below here, you are positive. So you have, in fact, something like that. This is the synchronization. Here, you have the synchronization. So if you go above, you go back. If you go below, you increase. So it's a fixed point, and it's a stable fixed point. Okay? So you have a fixed point at the synchronization. Now, the atmospheric effect puts, in fact, a bulge that is in a slightly different way. It will be here. The one component, the biggest component, will be here. So it will be an accelerating effect. And in this case, if it's strong enough, it goes like that. Only when you are close to synchronization. So the picture far away is still the same. So now you have something like that, which means I should not that now this point is unstable, and you have now two fixed points here and here that become stable. And this one, if the effect is strong enough, will be bigger than zero. You go all across zero, so you get a negative rotation. This is what we have for Venus. So the question now for the crossing of the chaotic zone is that this picture, if you have no planetary perturbation, will depend on the initial condition. The fact that you have this chaotic zone makes that any initial condition, you will cross this chaotic zone. In chaotic zone, you shuffle everything. So any initial condition can bring you to one of these points, and in particular to the retrograde rotation. And also, there is you were asking, but for Mars, you have a chaotic motion of this obliquity of Mars, and the obliquity is going from 0 to 60 degrees. When we have evidence, geological evidence of high obliquity in the past, like 45 degrees or more.
Okay, so let me thank you very much for this.